After the US first put a man on the moon and the Soviet Union landed a rover that could freely move across its surface, the USSR's next goal would be more ambitious, to finally touch down on Mars. The Soviets had been developing a space program to send a rover to Mars since 1960, but it wasn't until the launch of Mars 2 in 1971 that they were close to achieving their objective. However, the rover crashed on the planet after a landing malfunction. The mission was shortly followed by Mars 3, which completed its goal of becoming the first spacecraft to land on the red planet and capture footage of its rocky surface. Minutes after its activation, the rover began transmitting data back to Earth. But 14 seconds after it started moving, the first man-made object to reach Mars lost signal. Before going black, the rover transmitted a fuzzy black-and-white image. It then went silent forever. Russia initially kept the Mars 3 landing a secret. And for almost 40 years, the mystery of what happened to the spacecraft remained unanswered. It wasn't until the late 2000s that an astonishing satellite discovery left the space community in awe. Soviet Mars Program. As far back as the 19th century, scientists have been fascinated by the idea of finding life on another planet. That uncertainty has pushed humanity to develop technology for spacecraft that could one day reach the Moon, Mars, and beyond. During the space race, both the US and the Soviet Union strived to be the first nations to discover life on another planet and to achieve military nuclear dominance in outer space. The USSR put the first man and woman into outer space, launched the first successful multi-crew mission, and landed the first man-made object on the Moon. In turn, the US was the first nation to put a man on the Moon. In an interview with Radio Liberty, spaceflight and member of the British Interplanetary Society, Brian Harvey, said, quote, "In what we call the space race, there were many sub-races, and there were sub-races to Venus and to Mars." The Soviets had been planning an ambitious program to send spacecraft to Mars going back to the early 1960s. The goal was to explore its surface, but the planet also held the promise of extraterrestrial life. According to the scientific community, Mars is the only planet in the solar system that closely resembles Earth. Its rotation period is 24 hours and 37 minutes, while its angled tilt to its orbital plane is 64.8 degrees compared to Earth's 64.5. Both have similar seasonal changes, and evidence indicates that vegetation and water could have been part of Mars's ambiance once. The Soviet Mars program evolved steadily alongside its lunar project. Russia strived to send orbiters, landers, and probes to Mars before the Americans did. The first Russian attempt to reach Mars dates back to 1960, when the Mars 1M probe was launched, but failed to reach orbit. The subsequent Mars 2M spacecraft were destroyed during launch. By 1971, the Soviet Union had developed the M4 program, encompassing the Mars 2 and 3 missions. Meanwhile, the Americans had the Mariner 9, a robotic space probe set to launch concurrently. V.G. Perminov, in his book about the Soviet Union's Mars exploration, The Difficult Road to Mars, wrote about that date's importance, quote, "The year 1971 was one of conjunction, when Earth and Mars were at a minimum distance from each other. This happens once in every 15 to 17 years, and is a very favorable time for Mars observation and for interplanetary flights as well. During these years, minimum power is required to deliver the spacecraft to Mars, and consequently, a heavier spacecraft can be launched on an interplanetary trajectory." Interplanetary flight. In early 1971, the USSR was ready to launch the Mars 2 and Mars 3 missions to land on the surface of the Red Planet. Both missions used identical spacecraft. Each one consisted of an orbiter module with an attached lander module containing a rover that would explore Mars' surface upon touchdown. According to NASA's Space Science Data Coordination Archive, quote, "The primary scientific objective of the Mars 3 descent module was to perform a soft landing on Mars, return images from the surface, and return data on meteorological conditions, atmospheric composition, and mechanical and chemical properties of the soil." Mars 3 was the first spacecraft to make a successful soft landing on Mars. Perminov, then lead designer of the Mars program, stated that the spacecraft descent module was mounted on the orbiter opposite the propulsion system. It was made of a spherical landing capsule with a 2.9-meter diameter conical braking shield, a parachute system, and retro rockets. It weighed 4,650 kilograms, including the lander's 1,000 kilograms. Additionally, the spacecraft was equipped with special instruments to study the temperature, solar radiation, wind velocity, and chemical composition of the Martian soil. Based on NASA's scientific report of the lander, quote, "Four aerials protruded from the top of the sphere to provide communications with the orbiter via an onboard radio system. The equipment was powered by batteries, which were charged by the orbiter prior to separation. Temperature control was maintained through thermal insulation and a system of radiators. The landing capsule was sterilized before launch to prevent contamination of the Martian environment." Each lander carried a Prop M rover, a remote-controlled vehicle that weighed no more than 5 kilograms. It had a small, square-shaped body equipped with the latest Russian technological innovations. It was also supported by 2 flat skis to provide clearance from the ground and be able to roam freely through the planet's red dunes. The rover was built to resist the harsh Russian environment, which scientists believe would be similar to Mars. The robot was connected to the lander by a 15-meter-long cable. That was as far as it could go. The Prop M rover was equipped with detection bars to avoid collision with rocks, unexpected falls and cavities, or rugged terrain. It also carried a densitometer and a penetrometer to measure the strength and density of the Martian soil. The cameras equipped on the lander would be used to monitor the movements of the rover. Signals sent from Earth to Mars would take around 5 to 20 minutes to reach the receiver. Although the system was overly primitive, the testing phase was successful. A colossal dust storm. Mars 2 was launched on May 19, 1971, and reached the Red Planet 6 months later on November 27th. During the landing maneuvers, the spacecraft's onboard computer issued an erroneous command that caused the lander to hit the surface before the parachute system was activated. The space vehicle was lost. The mission was followed by the launch of Mars 3 on May 28th. It reached the Martian surface on December 2, 1971. The lander successfully separated from the spacecraft and entered its designated trajectory. After almost 5 hours, the lander entered the Martian atmosphere and landed without any problems. Pimenov recalled that everybody in the control room was impatiently waiting for the rover to get into action, but they had to wait over an hour for the rover to send a signal. In his book, Pimenov wrote, quote, "The main engineer, Kodarev, gave a command to reduce the signal because it was too strong. Then, the telephotometer data were transmitted. There was a gray background with no details. In 14.5 seconds, the signal disappeared." The transmission stopped for no apparent reason, and no signal was ever received again. It was an abrupt halt that left the entire Russian space program wondering what had happened. Before blacking out, Mars 3 sent back a partial image that Pimenov described as a mere gray background with no details. After discussions with scientists and engineers, Pimenov went back to the peculiar image, searching for any additional data that could explain the mystery of the rover's sudden loss of contact. He remembered reading that during World War II, British radio operators often had malfunctions with their transmitters when working during dust storms in the Lebanese deserts. Pimenov concluded that Mars had lost contact with Earth due to a powerful dust storm that arose as the rover landed. He was later able to verify his conclusion when images from both Mars orbiters continued taking pictures of the Martian surface. Still, the dust storm completely obstructed the topography. The question of where the Mars lander and rover ended up remained unanswered. A mysterious apparition. When the Mars 2 and 3 missions were launched in 1971, the Soviet Union kept their outcomes a secret. The press was only notified that the USSR had successfully launched the 2 orbiters. It wasn't until the 1990s that the mission's details became public. For decades, space race aficionados and experts continued to wonder what had happened to the spacecraft after the dust storm halted all communications with Earth. But in 2007, renewed hope emerged as U.S. researchers from the High-Resolution Imaging Science Experiment published a 1.8 billion pixel Mars image titled Center of Soviet Mars 3 Landing Ellipse, urging the public to look for the Mars 3 or its remains. The experiment paid off, and by 2011, a Russian enthusiast claimed to have spotted light-colored debris resembling the Mars 3 parachute. By 2013, more aficionados helped find the lander, retro rockets, heat shield, and the white parachute used for landing. NASA has stated that further analysis is required to confirm if these objects belong to Mars 3. Meanwhile, its small rover remains to be found.